Now think about also like how many children are, particularly are black children, because of legacy parenting, they're told don't move out of that box, right? And other children are being raised like the world is yours. Remember the context, and that's why I think history, you know, Malcolm says, you know, history is the subject that's, you know, probably most important. No matter what you study, study history too, right? And so if you look at, you know, if it's science, study history and see how science was oppressive to people of color, but also how scientists can do right by people of color. You know, if you're in economics, look at how bad economic policy was used to oppress, you know, and depress black and brown communities, and how can it be used to further this push for equity and justice, right? And so when you look at the history of child rearing and parenting, right, how much of that was to keep your black child alive, right? Because back talking might get you Emmett Till'd, right? And so how many black families for generations raised that where white children, white families, they didn't have that, you know, that fear, that lingering, chronic, pervasive fear that, you know what, an overseer or police officer or a principal or whoever can, you know, a social worker, a judge, a lawyer, you know, if they look at my child as anything but quiet, meek, humble, silent, something bad could happen. The white child, you know, while the black child is being told to stay in this box, the white child or the affluent child, you know, who's come from influence and affluence, they're being raised like, hey, even an adult is your equal. And we know that historically, a white boy would address you as boy or your first name, yeah, right? Where you still had to say, yeah, Mr. Little Tommy, little Mr. Tommy, right? Like you were still putting Mr., right? That legacy continues, right? But that white child looks at you as you know, like, I'm your equal, right? So like, I hear you, but I'm your equal. And I'm being raised to advocate. Malcolm Gladwell in his book talks about, you know, affluent family taking their child, their 5 or 6 year old to the doctor. And the mother prompting the child, don't forget, ask the doctor, tell the doctor you're having this issue, make sure you ask them these questions, right? So here's this person of authority, this person that has all this knowledge. The 5 and 6 year old is like, yeah, I can question you. I can talk to you. I can advocate for me to you, right? Black child is like, hey, be quiet, you know? Don't be disrespectful, shh. Don't make too much noise. And then, yeah, shh. Don't ask them questions. Let's go. Come on, chop chop. You know, and it's a lot of context, right? Like I'm working 2 jobs. I got to get to the second one. I already took off. I'm hourly wage. I ain't got time for, you know, all of that stuff. In addition to the authority piece, right? And me wanting to look like I'm not a black parent that doesn't have control of my kid, right? Because that's a narrative about, oh, they can't control. And there's another thing. The sister is professor, and I forget her name. Somebody sent me a clip, and I have to watch all of it. But a part of what she was saying was like, you know, you have two parents, and you're talking about academically, that, you know, the white parent, the teacher gives the white parent's child a compliment. She says, oh, Johnny writes really well. She says, oh yeah, he writes really well. He's also doing this and that, and he's part of this club, that club, da da da. The black parent, they give the child a compliment. The black parent says, yeah, well, you don't see how he acts at home, or you don't see what he did the other day when he broke that dish in the kitchen and lied about it. The teacher's like, well, I'm talking about his writing, right? But what she said was some of that is also the context, the historical context. If that black child was looked at as skilled, he might get sold off, right? And so to protect him, I'm gonna be like, he ain't that good. He ain't good. Yeah, he got a lot of issues. Yeah, this, you know, if I know that, and not to compare the two, right? But if I have a car and I know that at any time, this person might steal it and they give me a compliment about it, I'm like, man, you know what? It's bad on gas. Like, yeah, it looks shiny, but underneath the hood, man, it started making all this noise down the road, like, right? And so some of that deflection is protection. Stay keeping a child in the box was protection. And so what we have to do is, one, that's why I think schools are so important, to be able to build the trust with the community. Because you can't say as a black person, like, oh yeah, you know, back to this idea of like, you know, being growing up black in America, all the institutions, yeah, they're bad, but the school, institution, the school is perfect, it's fine, it's not racist, right? We can say, yeah, the criminal justice, yeah, that needs to be reformed. The police department, that needs to be reformed. You know, health, housing, all this stuff needs to be reformed. Schools, they just need more money. That's all. There is nothing, no reform. My friend Chris, he talks about like, you know, reform. It doesn't even need to be reformed. It needs to be revolutionized. It needs to be started over. Like, talking about slavery reform, that ain't going to get it. Like, yeah, we can keep slavery, but just let's reform it. Let's just eat around the edges a little bit. Let's just tinker with this. And then slavery can stay as an institution. In a lot of ways, that mindset about reform for schools is the same thing. Let's eat around the edges. Let's just add a couple dollars. Let's do this without fundamentally changing the experience that black children have inside of our schools. That's what the work is all about.
Thank you so much for watching I Never Knew TV.
Please subscribe, comment, like.